So, Mr. Gombos, would you like to make some announcements for us?
Yeah, we've been quite busy the last couple of years, and a lot of this, some of these things, were projects that I was trying to work on as I started. First and foremost, it's a property that we're very, very happy about. We've championed. Actually, we published the novel in 2005, and you probably, most of you are familiar with a little anime called The Last Vampire. But so we have recently acquired the rights to publish the Blood Plus manga series. We have Blood Plus, the staple series, Adagio Yakujoshi. Additionally, we'll be doing the novels, so we'll have Blood Plus, the novel series, and Russian Rose. And to me, that's an exciting one. So it's something that we've, our founder, President Mike Richardson, he's supported it for a long time, the series, and loved the, not the series, but the property. Loved the anime, and the book is fantastic as well. So that's a big one that we're excited about, and we hope that you will pick up a volume and leaf through it and perhaps buy one. Next on the list is number two. Ghost Talkers Daydream. You might be familiar with the anime by Genion, and this additionally should be hitting shelves in summer of 2008. So I'd like your patience on that, and it promises to be a very exciting series, and I'm pretty sure most people have heard of it or at least familiar with it through the anime.
How do you like Vanna White down there?
Like this.
Yeah. A little more familiar. Yeah. Great.
Maybe our letters to her might be
helpful. Quickie fans won't be disappointed. We're doing a book called The Color of Rage, originally titled Colored by Kazuo Quickie and Seisaku Kano. It's quite obscure, but we'll be passing these around so people would like to look at them.
This is real hardcore Stephanie's Koike stuff. This is the real deal.
Not like softcore stuff.
Don't steal them. You've had enough stolen from us lately.
One of our, as you might know, last year, December, we launched our Alonwood line with Vanya, the Explosive Delivery Man. I'm not sure if you read that, but it's a fantastic, fantastic series. And released several other series since then, Shaman Warrior, Excess Hybrid, Hanami, International Love Story, and continuing that is a wonderful, wonderful, beautiful shoujo title entitled Bride of the Water God. And I'm not sure if anyone here has heard of that, but we have posters at Dark Horse Booth, so if you'd like to come by and learn more about that, or pick up a poster. On the opposite side is the MP Psycho poster, so you can pick one of each. Not that, you know, unless you're hanging posters from the ceiling on a string, you can hit all people with that poster. Vampire V, as you know, we're co-publishing with Digital Manga. However, we're publishing the other movie from way back on VHS, the anime, Wind Named Amnesia. You guys might be familiar with that. So that'll be available in English as well, in all the format, with the original illustrations by Yoshitaka Amano. We're excited about that. I wanted to say that about Wind Named Amnesia, but I forgot, so. All right. Last but certainly not least is something that I personally have really, really wanted to bring to the U.S. for a very, very long time. And I know the fans wanted it because we've heard it. But we acquired the rights to Gantz, the manga. So we've been working quite a bit with Shueisha to try and bring that over here. And, you know, there have been talk about when it would ever arrive in America. Why hasn't it? And that's the question, why hasn't it? But I personally feel, and this is really kind of objective, doesn't have anything to be working with Dark Horse, but I felt that Gantz was a wonderful home, or Dark Horse is a wonderful home for Gantz, so we're hoping to have that out by summer of next year, the first volume. So I can ask for your support on that, and hopefully you've all heard of it and would like to pick it up and read it, since we've all probably seen the anime here, I'm guessing. Hopefully.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's a that's our string of announcements for Anime Expo. We'll have some more at San Diego as well, but we're a little reticent about announcing stuff that's not in concrete. So that's our announcement list for 2007.
I actually do want to kind of make a personal comment on something related to our publishing. Are any of you guys reading Eden right now?
Yeah!
That's my dude. That's exactly why I have to make this announcement, however. Eden is a series that we're publishing right now that is one of my personal favorite manga series that we're doing. It's actually one of my favorites that we've ever done. And it's one that, you know, maybe not a lot of people know about, and we're not seeing, like, you know, a lot of fan response on it. So I really, really want to encourage every one of you, if you guys like our books and you like the stuff we publish, like, please, please check this series out, because we want to keep it going. And, you know, and what's up? Well, you're going to have to read.
What kind of publicity is that?
Yeah.
Oh. Like I said, my heart's been stomped on. Computer's gone, you know.
But definitely come by booth 9:30.
Yeah, actually, I was going to say.
We've got copies. You can come by and take a look through
it. Yeah, come by and check it out. Just take a look through it. And it really is, like, anyone who's really enjoyed, like, anyone enjoy any of the, like, Shiro stuff or any of the Otomo stuff at all? Like, it's kind of in that same thing. But it's a really kind of a, it's a nice complex story. It's got really great characters, really strong characters. It's a really, really, really fantastic series, and it's one that I really want to see us keep doing. So please come check it out. That's all. That's my personal aside. So, anybody else have anything you want to talk about before we start taking questions?
Okay. Nothing offhand. I'd like to bring up the, I'll be happy to answer any specific questions you might have about what, you know, the titles I'm working on. When I start passing these around, you get a look at some of these new titles for these.
But we'd be really, really grateful if you would return them.
Exactly, because in many cases, you literally have copies we'll be using to work with. You could never have too many.
Don't miss it.
Due to death, we had to postpone the series.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I guess we're going to go ahead and open it up to questions. You guys want to walk over the microphone right there? Go ahead and pass line right on up. Sort of call on you guys. This is one at a time. We'll wait till these guys get back up here.
Love it.
Okay, so go ahead and start with you.
My name is John Paul Giacristo, and I'm a really huge Berserk fan. And basically, I wanted to know the Berserk like release intervals, like when you're going to release new volumes, and how often, and how many are out now. Like, so I'm not entirely sure.
Right now, 17 just came out. We got it at our booth. 18 we're working on right now, so it'll be done pretty soon. Right now, the release schedule, I believe, is bi-monthly. It's coming out quite fast, actually, given, you know, all the work that goes into it. So we've actually got all the release dates on our website. If you go to darkhorse.com, just type in Berserk in the search bar and you'll find out when all the new volumes are coming out.
Okay, and also, games for me, like, I know you guys just published, you know, manga and everything, but if anyone was ever to get a license for the Berserk games...
Oh, like the video game?
Yeah, to, like, purchase for you.
I don't know. We haven't really done much in the video game vein, so I don't think it would be us, but I'd love to see it, because apparently it kicks ass.
Yeah.
I haven't had a chance to play it yet.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome. There was a limited release game.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
No, thank you.
No problem.
I just have a question about the 2-year series. Satsuma Gishide, how many volumes is that going to be?
Four, I believe, but yeah.
Okay, four has already been solicited?
No, four has not been solicited yet.
Okay, so sometime this year?
We're hoping, yes, but we'll see. I mean, it's...
Sure.
It's fortunate to solicit it soon, I believe, but it's one of the slow, so, yeah. Yeah, so we... Like, that's your patience on that, so...
My yeah, it's going to be this fall, like, it's okay. September, October.
Yeah, just one of those. Also, Red Go to Zombie Shop. That one. That one, you guys still doing that one? Like, I just wonder if I just caught up to it, or is six the last one we're going to see?
It's on hiatus, yeah.
This is hard. This is actually many translated. Rick goes on the so it's very dear to his heart.
Oh, okay. And, so.
I'm really glad you like it. I'm trying to do everything I can to keep it going, because there are, obviously, I love it, or I wouldn't be doing it, but it just goes to show you that, you know.
Okay. Well, if you do stop, if you have something with it, please just, don't stop on a cliffhanger, man. It's like,
I don't. Six.
Yeah.
Six.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot, man.
Yeah, thank you.
I remember last year you mentioned re-releases of new versions of the Shiro Masamune material. I was wondering if you had any updates in that regard.
Well, actually, there have been some delays with that. We were hoping to have it out earlier this year. However, there's just been some difficulties along the way, and Nothing I want to necessarily go into specifically, but I can tell you we will be publishing them, and we're going to get them out as soon as we can.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you.
Sorry, I don't have a double answer for that one.
I was wondering what happened to the Helsing series that I bought, like, early last year, 1 through 7, or 1 through 6, and I somehow found 7 a few days later. And it seemed like it stopped in a cliffhanger, and I don't know, are you guys going to keep picking that up?
Yeah, yeah. We actually...
No,
I was just going to say, we actually just caught up. What happened is that we got the first volumes out really quickly, and then we kind of got caught up with them. We caught up to Japan, so now 8 will be coming out this week, actually.
Yeah.
And then it's going to be sort of on a little slower schedule, just because, you know, we're publishing them as quickly as we can get them translated.
We can't put the English editions out until the Japanese ones come out, and since we caught up to Japan.
Sometimes happens. It's a good thing, I think, you know, but we certainly want to have the book out there, but we can't, even if you see parts of it serialized, you know, like Volume 9, part of it might have been serialized, and people say, I've seen parts of Volume 9 online, why are you guys so slow in putting this out, you know, and it's like, it's not us, we're just caught up, that's the case sometimes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for reading. Hello there.
Yo.
Hi, how are you? Can I call the microphone?
I think, I think
hold it up. All right. Well, I just have to say that Dark Horse, it's a fresh breath of air in the manga world today, because I'm just sick and tired of going to my manga library, the manga place where I buy stuff, and everything is pink. Everything is purple. And every single book that I pick up has a Dark Horse on it. So, since you guys are going into the edgy stuff, it will be possible for that. It will be a right place to be for Dark Horse to get onto the mixed martial arts manga. That it's the mixed martial art world, like the tournaments, the everything. It's picking up, and in Japan there is a healthy, I will say, quantity of titles. So will be Dark Horse interesting in kind of like start up the mixed martial art manga world? Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, well, thanks.
You're going to be really bummed words. When you see that MPD Psycho is going to go all pink after the first volume. Just to keep you guessing.
Yeah, you know, we've looked at that in the past, and you and I have talked, and Shaman was certainly a title that we had looked at in the past. I mean, right now, it's not something we're absolutely not going to do, and I'm a fan of K1 and Pride and all sorts of MMA, but we don't have any tentative plans to do anything right, like that right now, but it's certainly not saying that we're not going to do it in the future, but... I know, man, that they're, that, you know, you're a big fan, and I love having you come over to the booth, but I wish we could, you know, publish everything that everyone wanted, but we certainly we'll keep in mind at least one series.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, that's it. It's just like to heads up, like, hey, this is cool too.
No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Kind of on the last note of MPD Psycho going shoujo, I know you guys publish a lot of more dark, gritty stuff, especially like Blade of the Immortal and Berserk and that kind of, those kind of titles, but MPD Psycho oftentimes goes into like actual, like really depraved stuff, so how are you guys expecting that? Like, do you think it'll affect your sales? I noticed that you guys are selling the first volume at your booth, so how have your sales been going on that so far? Really excited about it.
We got bored of dark and gritty, so we said, what's after that? Depraved. Okay.
No bottom level to hell.
Yeah. It's like, hey, let's...
You know, the weird thing is that Eiji Otsuka used to be a editor of a shoujo magazine. And he's also...
I did not know that.
You know, he's got a very interesting background. You know, he's an anthropology major, which I think is really great preparation for writing stories. Mm-hmm. Something a lot of people don't realize about MPD Psycho is how funny it is. It's very much... It's not just a story. It's not like Seven. Mm. You know, this is basically a very social, you know, comedy about, you know, madness in contemporary Japanese society. And, you know, what it was coming off of was, you know, the Aum Shinrikyo terrorist attacks in 1995. People found out there really were weird cults in the midst of Japan, and they really did look like everyone else. Mm-hmm. And people who seemed completely normal and went to school and got PhDs and just wanted to kill everybody and take over the world, you know. So real life, of course, is much more horrible and depraved than anything Eiji Otsuka drew.
It's almost as if you have to be extra provocative to get people's attention away from the real news. So there's kind of a weird effect that goes on there. We have kind of what we call the worst scene theory when it comes to publishing a manga. If we're okay with the worst scene, we're okay with everything else. So with MPD Psycho, I went through the first 11 volumes, you know, and had gone through the first 10 and thought, okay, well, there's some kind of extreme stuff in here, but, you know, we've done stuff like this in this manga or that manga. And then, I came to that scene in volume 11.
Yeah.
So I brought it into the president of the company, you know, because he wants to stand behind all the work. And, you know, I felt like I was trying to sell him dirty postcards. Look at this. you could see this. And, you know, he looked over and said, So this will break new ground. We agreed to publish it uncensored. The book is going to... there are one or two covers which we're going to have to put a... You know the paper bands they have in the Japanese? So we'll just put that under the shrink wrapping, but we're not going to change the art or anything.
Never.
And, of course, you can just take the band off. Recently, I was reading a review of the Kurosagi Corpse Delivery Service in the Library Journal, of all places. And they were saying, this manga is full of implied unnatural sex. You know, it's depraved, horrible acts, and all that. And they said, but they said it's also a really good social satire and about the way people treat death, and the banter between the characters is really great. And I said, so I recommend this for your adult collections in your library. And I thought, wow, here's a librarian who really gets it. You know, I want there to be a place for... Most of the manga, if not all, that we publish is seinen manga, you know, manga for older readers. And I want there to be just as much a place for that as there is for shoujo and shonen. And I don't want adult comics either to be dismissed as trash, and I also don't want you to have to claim that it's another Mouse or another Watchmen every time. It should be just okay to have them be good entertainment with good characters and all that, just like on TV. You know, because that's what, you know, manga is in Japan. It's like, you know, it's accepted like television is. So the fact that a librarian, you know, writing the library journal could see that, you know, gave me a lot of hope. So, you know, it's shrink-wrapped. There's a warning sticker on it. It's definitely not for under 18 readers, and we would never want to push this kind of material. You know, I'm the editor of Oh My Goddess as well. You know, so I do Oh My Goddess and Corpse Delivery Service.
It's a little variety.
So they kind of keep the universe in balance. Between them. Neither must or prevail.
Going off of that really, really fast, okay, yeah. Hiroaki Samura's... art book. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. I'm sure you know which one I'm talking about. Do you guys have any plans to bring that to the U.S.? I don't know if it would make it.
I get to look at that
anything.
For the first time in Japan, and we thought, wow, you know, this is really, it's Samura, so it's really, really great stuff, but we haven't really thought about licensing that yet. So,
okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, we've done Ohikoshi, so.
He tricked me into buying it. It had that nice cover of people in the park.
Yeah.
I was a little surprised, but okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Hi. I have two questions, actually, but if that's okay. But the first one is the Junji Ito series, Museum of Terror, you only put out 3 volumes of that, and I know there's a lot more. There's like 15, I think. Do you have any plans of keep going with that or no?
It's currently been discontinued, actually, so yeah.
Okay, and my second question is, I know you put out, like, a lot of, I guess, depraved some stuff. Like, we just went over, basically, and, like...
Is that the new buzzword, depraved? When you think Dark Horse, you think depraved.
Nasty, yeah. Are you going to go into ever, like, Gudo, like, Suehiro Maruo sort of things, or no?
Well, how should I put it? We're not... it's not our mission, necessarily, to shock the bourgeoisie and all that sort of thing. You know, a lot of the manga... You know, MPD Psycho didn't appear in an obscure magazine. It appeared in the same magazine as that Neon Genesis Evangelion, you know, Sergeant Frog. You know, that's the suitable reading demographic. You like Sergeant Frog, you'll like MPD Psycho. That's the that's the assumption there in Japan. So it's not like we're trying to, you know, we don't have a particular Eroguro mission. Having said that, you know, I'm sure Suehiro Maruo is extremely talented. Mm-hmm. If any of you have ever read his stuff in, I want to say Comics Underground Japan...
Yeah,
it's a collection that came out. It's this amazing short story called Planet of the Jap, which is one of the sharpest, you know, satires I've ever read. We were looking at some stuff the other day by an artist who's somewhat similar to Maduro. You probably know the artist, but I don't want to mention the person's name. So we're not opposed to that kind of thing at all.
So.
Okay, and I just like to say I really like the stuff you're putting out, like, you know, MPD Psycho, Octopus Girl, School Zone, stuff like that. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
How you doing? I'm pretty much into the old school stuff. I was just curious, is there any plan on releasing the actual manga or graphic novel form of 3x3 Eyes?
As far as I know, we don't.
3x3 Eyes was a much more popular series in Japan than Oh My Goddess was. I believe it had 35 volumes. You know,
right.
How many?
I think it got up to 40.
Yeah, and that's sort of, there lies the problem. It's very difficult to commit to release a series of that length. There's kind of a Darwinian process that goes on. In 1994, I'm sure that no one could predict that the longest-running manga to this day in the U.S. would be Oh My Goddess. Back then, people still thought manga meant, you know, people's heads exploding and, like, you know, samurai and things like that. And then you had this manga that came around that was kind of this gentle comedy where people had tea and, you know, things like that. What Oh My Goddess was getting at was, it's not a shoujo manga, but it has some of the qualities, many of the qualities, as a matter of fact, that a lot of people like in shoujo. And so it has kind of crossover readership. And what Oh My Goddess was trying to say is that there's, people have an appetite for that too. I like to say that among the things that people like out of manga and anime that they don't get out of American culture, it's not just the breaking of taboos to be like extreme and like violent and sexual. It's also about sensitivity, you know, emotional sensitivity, gentleness, empathy. That's tough for Americans to do. You know, we're not a particularly subtle culture, you know, and even if we can do it, we laugh at it. And it's harder, and we would laugh at it even if we like it. It's sometimes easier for us to accept a bunch of Japanese high school students being nice to each other than it is for us to accept high school students being nice to each other. It's almost like manga and anime provides a safe cultural space where you can be gentle and get away with it. So the, did I lose my choo-choo of thought here? There's a Darwinian process that goes on. We did not stop publishing 3x3 Eyes because everyone was buying it, saying, oh, we'll show them. You're going to buy it? We won't publish it anymore. Right. Oh My Goddess sort of survived and 3x3 Eyes didn't. So if we were starting over again, I would actually think twice before suggesting doing 3x3 Eyes in the first place, for the simple reason it's such a long series. It's got nothing to do with the quality of the series. Although I'm actually more of an Every Day is Sunday, you know, a fan. I'm very sorry that it did not work out. And if you look at the history of Dark Horse, you'll find there are other things that didn't work out as well. Unfortunately, you can't publish manga for 19 or 20 years, and, you know, everything doesn't go your way. You know, there are cool manga we publish which are forgotten about now, which, you know, who knows, maybe someone will ask a question. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
I was wondering if Dark Horse would be interested in publishing Freesia.
Freesia?
Yeah. Freesia. Freesia. Freesia.
By, who was the creator of that?
I'm not sure. Someone told me to ask it.
Okay. I've heard of Freesia.
Yeah. I mean, we'll take a look, but there's no plan right now to... That yeah. We've.
I think it's kind of like empty
side. Well,
it's like you can put a hit on somebody if you want to murder them, and it's legal.
it's certainly something we consider.
Fun.
You know, another thing about Dark Horse is that we, unlike a number of companies, we're not primarily a licensing company.
Yeah.
We primarily create original comics. I'm actually the only editor at Dark Horse, I think, who only works on manga.
Yeah.
Other people work on original comics as well, which I think is amazing. I come out of a licensing background, but Dark Horse is full of people who have to create comics that don't exist.
Right.
You know, that's why I don't get too upset sometimes if we can't do a manga, because at least I can enjoy the Japanese version. It already exists out there.
Right.
But, you know, Dark Horse has done hundreds of comics would never have existed at all.
Yeah.
I like to think that helps us with our manga adaptation. We know how hard it is to create a good comic, whether it's Japanese or American.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever we look at a work, we know it was not extruded from some magical fun factory called Japan. There was an artist and a writer who had to sit down, had to work at it, had to lay down those screen tones, had to make deadlines. That's the most important part. You know, when we talk to Japanese publishers, they know that we've gone through what they do. You know, we also work with artists. We try hard for creativity. And, you know, quite a few of our manga are published in foreign editions, including Japanese. I was just looking at the Japanese edition of 300 the other day. The Spartans, like, end every sentence with Zul, you know, there. So, but Yeah, so we're proud that our manga have been, our comics have been published in Japanese as well.
Mm. Is it difficult for American fans to absorb certain Japanese cultural taboos, like the extremes of Japanese culture?
I think there's I think people who are into manga and anime, most of them I think have a desire to do so. You know, in the old days it was thought that you had to remove cultural references. But so much conventional wisdom has proven to be wrong. Take not flopping manga. It would seem to completely go against common sense that anyone would like reading an unflipped manga. Because every time you'd read the page, you'd be reminded there's something wrong with this. It's not like American. That turned out to be completely wrong. Nothing to do with it. And on the contrary, nowadays people want to know the cultural references. One thing I've been doing with Oh My Goddess is we've been re-releasing the old editions that we originally released in flopped format. And I've been going back and putting back in Japanese cultural references here and there, usually bothering Mr. Gombos and Rico about some obscure Japanese pop singer who's on the charts for 5 seconds in 1988, you know, this joke about, you know, and thank God for Google as well. But, you know, this is a big, there's 300 million people in America. We're the most diverse nation on Earth. So even though none of this manga and anime was meant for us, there are people here who are going to like it and discover it for reasons which wouldn't even occur to the original creators. And that's one of the reasons why the future of anime and manga increasingly lies outside of Japan. I don't mean Japanese stuff changing to try to second guess what Americans or Italians or Chileans, you know, or French or Canadian, you know, readers like. I want it to stay the same. Just like Hollywood actually makes most of its money now outside the U.S., but if you go to see a Hollywood movie, it's the same old Hollywood movie. You don't look at it and say, oh, they're just putting that in there to please the Japanese guys, you know. So I'm hoping that's how anime and manga will stay. Mm.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hey. I'm hoping I have the right company. You are the ones who put out the Dirty Pair novel, or have been working on it.
It's coming out, yes.
Right. It is coming out. I just wanted to say thank you as a longtime fan, just because it's like...
Oh, great.
It's been a long time since I had a chance to see what that would be like, the original works were like. I'm wondering if they're even as obscure as they are, would you ever consider doing like maybe even more of the novels or Dirty Pair or Crushage or anything like that?
Would you like the actual comic we had, the Dirty Pair comic that we did, the Adam Warren one? Is that what you're talking about?
No.
We're doing the novels as well.
Yeah, the novels.
And that hasn't actually, they haven't come out yet.
Well,
hopefully we'll do a ton, but we'll get the first ones out first.
Is Dana Lewis translating the novels?
Dana Lewis is involved. I think she's doing kind of like the Khonshu where she looks over. But John
yeah, she Thomas was. Is actually right, as you know, she did the original ones back in the day for Great mm-hmm. Adventure Dirty Pair.
So, yeah, they're coming out this fall. And okay. So, yeah, we'd like to put them all out. But,
solid.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just want to see them come out finally.
We're very excited about novels in general. I think they've been the last frontier of Japanese pop culture because, you know, music, mm-hmm. Anime, manga, even if you don't know the language too well, you can get a lot out of them. But novels, unless you're pretty fluent, you're kind of sunk.
Yeah.
So, so we're very happy to make that, you know.
There's been a lot of interest in Dirty Pair novels, too. I was really, really happy about that. That, you know, yeah. It's around almost surprising that you're like, wow, this stuff is really good. We're really happy to see novels about the Dirty Pair come out. So,
I'm
surprised.
Ever since I saw Project Eden, I've been like, and read articles about this type of stuff. I'm like, oh, see what that's like. So,
yeah.
So, keep up the good work.
Thank you. I mean, I would say, I mean, we enter into every publishing program with the hope that we can complete it, and when we can't, it actually does literally break our hearts to have to leave it on, you know, a cliffhanger or whatever. So
we have actual jar of broken hearts that we have put in there over the years. So.
Hello. The Koike series you just announced and were passing around.
Yes.
Is that going to be published in the Bunko format like the others?
It's going to look exactly like that.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah. I like Koike.
It's like our Crying Free Man.
I was rereading Lone Wolf and Cub the other day, and I was just like, this is so small.
That's an awesome format. Koike came up with it. You know, where he moves all of his mangas through the convenience stores in Japan, the Family Mart chains and all that. So you go in for little, snacks, come out little, depraved, historical violence.
My only experience with MPD Psycho was I was picking up Shonen Ace at the time that it was running. The MPD Psycho shorts, are those in the back or
no.
those
that's separate? Separate series.
Yeah. Separate yeah. series. Okay. All right. Well, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Anybody?
All right. Come on.
Well, if things come up, you can feel free to
Yay.
Hey, oh, hey, there we go.
What's the status of Oh My God, It's Colors?
Colors. Sorry. It's like you have to be a certain age to get that joke.
It's a great
okay,
song.
Some people know. it's currently, I'm currently working on it. And I'm hoping to get it done as soon as possible. That's the, does that make sense? Yeah.
Why was it delayed?
It turned out to be a lot more complicated project than we thought. The real issue is the encyclopedia. There's a 40-page encyclopedia of Oh My Goddess. Everything is cross-referenced. However, we also wanted to make it useful. The problem is that there are two versions of Oh My Goddess. There's the unflopped version we released for many years, and there's the current one. We wanted to make it useful to both readers, you know, because people read it in the libraries, you know, people still have the old editions. So the encyclopedia gets translated, and then someone has to be familiar with the actual series. In this case, it has to be me, the editor. I go through and check the translation and make sure that everything is, you know, fits the way things are rendered in the English edition. Then I also want to make sure, oh, yes, but in the first edition it was called this, but in the second edition it was called this, and make sure the references are all right. It's a bit of a pain, but you know, I'm hoping that it will be useful. And I know there's a lot of Oh My Goddess trivia and information out there on the net, but I think there are going to be things in here which are new to a lot of people. And also, the original Oh My Goddess was released several years ago, and you know, some things have been updated since then. I'm not particularly proud of the delays. You know, it's not a, but I am. You know, I am working towards it. You know, steadily. So, you know, every single thing, you know, will, you know, Bill Dandy's broomstick, you know, gets its own paragraph and so forth. I almost brought my laptop. Or did I bring it here with me?
I'm not sure.
Maybe I can get some work on it done while we're. Yeah, so to show my sincerity, I'm actually going to try to do some work on it during the panel. Next question.
I'm not exactly sure if you guys are huge fans of Berserk, but I'm sure you guys are. I was just wondering, what's your favorite character and what's your favorite scene in the entire manga that you read so far?
Ooh, I can do this one. Oh man, favorite scene.
I can tell you what's not my favorite scene.
As far as favorite characters, it's a little hard to say. There's so many minor characters that pop up for only a little bit, and they're so strong. Like, I really like Jill. I thought she was an amazing character, you know, there for two volumes, but I think she was just a beautiful, beautiful presentation of, you know, a young girl in really unfortunate circumstances. I really liked Judo a lot.
Yeah,
that scene in the eclipse just broke my heart. That was terrible. Yeah. And, you know, I like all the regulars. You know, Casca and Guts are awesome. But what I really like about that series is I find that, you know, no matter how minor a character is, there's so much thought put into what they're doing, what they're saying, that you can care about a character you see for maybe 10 pages. And he just does such a good job with that. As far as favorite scenes, that's a little tricky. I think the eclipse, you know, as atrocious as it was, I think there were a lot of good scenes there. I think especially when Guts encounters his friends one by one.
I agree.
And then finds out exactly what, you know, is wrong with them. I think that's, you know, it's such a great moment in just straight up horror manga. It's amazing.
I definitely agree.
There's a lot of other really, really solid points. Actually, one of my favorite things, I think, in the Berserk series is actually the prototype story. If you've read that, the prototype is really cool. It's basically the submission piece that he did to present Berserk to publishers when he wanted to get it out there. So you get to see his first crack at the universe he created. And it's really interesting because you read it, and it very much is Berserk as we know it today, but there's subtle differences. And you can really see how he changed it from, you know, the submission point to when he really started getting into the manga proper. And the little things he changed, the little things he adjusted, the way Guts is kind of presented early on. And something like that I think is so neat because it gives you a look into the early creative process that I don't think you often get with manga. Normally you see the first volume and that's where you go. But to get a chance to really see the early stages before it really became a running series, I think is really interesting.
Where could you get that?
It's in volume, I want to say 15 or 16. I can't remember exactly, but it's in our volume. 14?
I thought it was that.
14. It's 14, 15, or 16, but it's definitely in our volume in the same place it appeared in the Japanese edition. So come by the booth and I can show you.
Okay, sure.
No problem.
Hi. Hello. First off, I want to thank you for re-releasing the Gunsmith Cats in a real big book.
No
this
problem.
Keep me busy. Second question, when are you going to release Burst Volume 2?
Burst 2, actually, the printer proofs, or the books, the comp copies that we have are already in the office, so it should be out
very, very soon.
Momentarily.
Very soon?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
All right, and Volume 3 of this big thing?
Also, just arrived also in the office, yep. So momentarily.
Yeah, if you go to darkhorse.com, you can find out release dates for any of our books as well. So just go to darkhorse.com, little search box, type in Gunsmith Cats, and it'll give you everything chronologically. So you can find out the first thing that came out all the way up to what's coming out in the next few months.
Yeah, but sometimes those dates are off. I mean,
yeah sometimes they're off.
We're assuring you, yeah, it'll be out soon. I mean, they could be very well putting it on the board of shelves as we speak. I don't know, but yes.
Go get it now.
I'm glad you like
Thank
it.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, well, the Gunsmith Cats Omnibus is really nice. I was wondering if you're planning on doing the Omnibus treatment for any of your other series, like particularly like older out-of-print series, like, I say, Club 9 Omnibus. Yeah.
We're doing it a lot with a lot of our American comics, yeah. Like a lot of our older American comic series. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, if the Gunsmith Cats Omnibus does well, I mean, it's a program that we could look into, you know, doing for some of those titles, but as of right now, there's nothing planned yet. But, you know, you can look at everything as sort of a testing ground. You know, if okay. We get a good response on them, then, you know.
But you're more? Certainly not the first person to ask, like, you know, really, like, yeah, what's Michael or Club 9, what you could put him in an omnibus and get, you know, the entire series out. It comes up again and again and again, and it is something we're thinking about, but like, as Jeremy said, it's more prevalent kind of with our American comics, and it's kind of a testing ground with Gunsmith Cats, which seems the reception has been really well for that.
Yeah, it's done really, really well so far, but...
Cool. Well, look forward to hearing good news. Thanks.
Yeah, no problem.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Anybody else?
Anyone?
I think the more questions we get, the more work on colors will get done over here. So,
that's
bring
right.
it.
No, he's already shut the laptop. You see, this is why this book's not out. It's fits and starts. All right. Well, I guess that brings us to the end.
Right? Yeah.
What time is it? How are we doing on time?
Actually, there's one last question that I was like asking, and I just want to run this by you guys again. As far as manga that you know is unlicensed to this point, what do you guys want to see? Like, what would you like to see us go for that no other publisher has got yet? Are there any titles we should know about? Yo! Trees Burning? Okay, one second, let me write that down. What was the creator again? Hiroshi Motomi. Hiroshi Motomi, okay. All right, who else has something?
Zipang by Kaiji Kawaguchi.
Sorry, what was the title?
Zipang.
Zipang, okay. Yo.
What's the title?
All right, got that one. Yeah, no problem. Yeah, white shirt there. Oh, Gonna Guy, yeah.
Yeah, that's what we hear a lot.
That is a good point. I love the Devilman manga. There's a fantastic English edition called The Devil's Incarnation that very hard to find. It came out in the 80s, but just fantastic stuff.
Hey.
I can hear you.
Rec. R-E-C. Okay. Anybody else? No.
As far as the comic Berserk, is there any other unpublished work that you guys have coming out?
Yeah, actually, we've got two that are already out. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but Japan and King of the Wolves.
He has an Old Oden, which is like the other part of King of the Wolves, but that we haven't done that. So, but that's quite a bit for Miura, but have you read those?
Yeah, I right now.
Great.
Awesome.
Okay.
We've got about 3.5 minutes left, so if you don't mind, if you could start passing back up to the front the various Japanese books.
Please.
Another recommendation, anything by Hideshi Hino.
We have the Lullabies from Hell at the booth.
Yeah, but...
More.
Remember, these are the books we will literally use to put out the English editions, so it's very important we receive them.
Hey.
I always wanted to see, how about an Aliens map?
Like Aliens, like the movie Aliens?
Yeah.
Ah.
Thank you.
Aliens that are and the guys like with one arm out shooting the other. a lot of room for imagination over there.
Yeah. Do you want to write it? I mean.
Yeah, but everybody's gonna say you're gonna look too much like the second movie. So.
Yeah. Come on, I know there's more than this. There's several volumes of Blood out there, and I think probably another copy of Gantz.
They're in the back.
No. All right, those will come up.
Cheers.
All right. Thank you. Man. Sorry about that.
No, you can just yell or scream. Yeah, it's so funny. We had, like, looked at that for a bit, but we're just not sure. But, yeah, it's... Yeah.
Hey, yellow shirt. Oh.
Not from Dark Horse, no.
Yellow shirt there, yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Voice?
Noise.
Noise, okay. Cool. All right. Hi. Yeah, sure. For example, like, let's say you guys are publishing manga, however, it's distributed in the version and the origin, whether or not you publish it, whether or not how you edit certain parts or something. Oh, I think in general our philosophy is really to leave things as is, as much as possible. We have had cases where the manga creators have actually requested us to make changes, so stuff like that happens, but unless a creator is actually like, okay, let's do this change, we like to leave things as they are. And really, like, you know, whether or not something's politically controversial or not, really, the way... Oh, I see, like, politically censored. Well, I guess then it's a matter of, you know, whether or not we can actually, you know, work with the publisher over there to get it over.
Maybe difficult to acquire the rights to begin with, if that's the case.
You'll notice in some of the editions, like our Crime Freeman edition versus the old one, there's like the pubic hair on the old one was present, but it scratched out our edition. That's because it was based off the most recent edition of the Japanese version and was not a Dark Horse edit. It's the edit that happened in Japan
and
based
it was
off
approved.
The most current edition. That's the way Mr. Koike wanted it. So, yeah.
And when Koike wants something, you listen, because if you've ever seen that guy, he's like a samurai.
But he brings sandwiches.
He does bring sandwiches. Yeah. He's like a sandwich samurai.
Hey.
There's an old one that's published by Tokyo Pop, Parasite, but I can't find it anywhere. Like, there might be like somehow
What? It's.
No?
Yeah, Del Rey's doing it.
Huh? Del Rey's doing story.
It. Del Rey? Yeah.
Yeah, basically our opinion is that the time to decide whether you can do a manga is before you license it. So, like, you know, I don't see the point of licensing a manga and then cutting and trimming to shape and all that. You know, remember, we're comics publishers. We want to stand behind the manga we do just like we'd stand behind the comics we do. Mm-hmm. I mean, we publish Frank Miller, who is not known for his, you know, liking of censorship. We're not trying to make trouble, but we are a publisher. We're not, the role of a publisher is to stand behind the books you publish. It's not to cringe and like say, oh, please let us do this, you know, we won't get in trouble, we'll cut out whatever you want. If that's your attitude, you shouldn't be in the publishing business. Publishing business should be, you don't have to, Right, I mean, we choose to license books, and if we don't like a book, if it offends us or bothers us, we won't release it. But if we do release it, we want to stand behind it. So.
Yeah. And incidentally, sort of related to that, if you come to our booth, you'll notice that a lot of volumes are shrink-wrapped. That's one of the ways that, you know, we make sure we're able to keep a lot of content, you know, print content that some people might find objectionable and get it out there just by wrapping it up in plastic. But if you ever see any of our titles in a bookstore and you like the way it looks but it's shrink-wrapped and you're not allowed to open it, go to our website and we put up previews of all of our books. So even if something's shrink-wrapped and you can't see it, go to the website and we've got, you know, some family-friendly pages up on the website for each book. So you can see what it looks like, get a feel for the art without having to worry about, you know, messing with a book that's wrapped up if the bookstore gives you a hard time about it. So yeah, it's always an option if you want to check those out.
And as Carl said in the past, the shrink wrap and the sticker aren't to protect the readers, but to protect the book. So.
Yep.
You know, and, you know, we're aware that America and Japan are different cultures, so, you know, we want to make reasonable efforts to educate people. The shrink wrap and the sticker is an indication that you may not want to stock this book. We're hoping you will. You know, we're hoping you'll look beyond that. But, again, it should be a compromise. You know, we have goals and aspirations as a publisher. we like these books and we'd like people to read them. And therefore, we have a position where we stand, and we want to meet people halfway. But meeting people halfway doesn't mean cutting out, you know, bits of the comic. That's the wrong approach.
I've seen shrink wrap before. I'm not sure if other publishers have done it, but is it a common thing for manga publishers in the U.S.?
The funny thing is that all Japanese books are shrink wrapped. Yeah, as you may know, if you ever go into it, it didn't used to be that way. I'm not sure why they did it. Although, admittedly, when Japanese books weren't shrink-wrapped, I read the ones that I wasn't supposed to read, you know, so I suppose the shrink-wraps...
But it's required if the book has adult content, so are a lot of them... Well, they're adult, yes, they are.
Like
Battle Royale. But Battle Royale probably would be shrink-wrapped.
It is, you know, yeah.
Crown Jean John probably not. So, I mean, you know, it could be, but generally it's an adult...
And that's, by the way, one of the reasons why we're somewhat opposed to a rating system, because... we are a comics publisher, and we fought a very long time to the idea that comics are on equal status as other forms of entertainment. Books don't have rating systems. You know, you don't see an age sticker on books. Why should comic books have them then?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know.
And if every company has their own rating system, it gets so convoluted that no one knows, you know. This is T14 Tier 1.2. So be careful. What does that even mean?
Right.
You know?
Nevertheless, we believe there are alternate ways to educate people, including consumers, retailers, librarians, and all that, about content. We just don't want to stamp a scarlet letter of shame, you know, in our books, because we're not ashamed of them. You know, we're proud of them. You know, we're not. Again, we're not saying that everything we publish is the greatest thing ever, but it is what it is, and we like it. So, and we hope that you will like it too. And we wouldn't waste our time with any book if we thought it was crap, because it takes a lot of work and a lot of money, you know, to publish everything. So, you know, we're not doing MPD Psycho just to shock people. We're doing it because we think it's a really great modern-day satirical horror, and it's done in a very, you know, very, very sharp manner.
So I've just been flagged out. We've got 1 minute left, so if anybody has any burning questions, we should get those going right now. Otherwise, I think we have to... Hi. Well, it's tricky. I think there's a lot of stereotypes about women in comic books that aren't necessarily true. I think, like you see in newspapers and magazines, and every few months, some, like, you know, a new title will come out and be like, oh, it's a title geared for girls. They're doing comics for girls now. Oh my God! And it's like, they've been doing comics for people forever. And I don't really believe that there's the idea of, you know, girls comics versus boys comics. I think, you know, there's comics. And people will like them, and girls, boys, it doesn't matter. And as far as you working in the company, I mean, I've had a lot of people ask me about how I feel about, you know, working in this industry, but I've honestly never really been conscious of the gender issue. I worked in a comic store for 5 years before I started here, and, you know, bunch of guys, bunch of girls in there, and we had a really diverse clientele. I never really noticed that, you know, it was all guys in a creepy little dark room, and, you know, a girl would kind of peek in and then run away. It's like, it's been a diverse business for ages, and, you know, sometimes I think people don't see it because, you know, maybe they're looking at a certain group of people or people who read a certain book, but honestly, I think that's just, you know, gender's not something that you should worry about in this business. You know,
actually,
if you like it, you do it, and we've got tons of girls working at the company.
Yeah, I was going to say,
women.
Yeah, we've got probably more women on staff at Dark Horse than we do men.
Hey.
Actually, unfortunately, we have to cut the panel right there.
All right. So thanks you guys so much for coming.
Yeah,
and
we appreciate
thank you so
it.
Much for reading all of our books.